Welcome to our first session on Bhagavad Gita. It's our fortune to discuss the scripture which is directly spoken by Lord Krishna himself. And Krishna is the Supreme Personality of Godhead, and that is repeatedly described in the scriptures, and it is very much evident from Bhagavad Gita itself. So, Bhagavad Gita is considered the basic and foundational scripture, and understanding of Bhagavad Gita is considered very foundational for our spiritual life. And the teachings of Bhagavad Gita include five major topics. They are Ishvara, the Supreme Personality of Godhead himself, Jiva, the living entity, Kala, the eternal time factor, or to be specific, Prabhupada says, from the beginning of the cosmic manifestation till the end. Okay, or Brahmaji's, the universe comes into existence at the beginning of Brahmaji's life, and at the end of Brahmaji's life, it again goes back into Mahavishnu's body. So then the calculation of time matters there. But in the spiritual world, time is like the three phases of time, past, present and future. They do not technically exist in one sense. Okay. Anyways, Ishvara, Jiva, Kala, Karma. Karma is activity and reaction to that action, or the system of whole actions and reactions is called karma. Okay, karma is the activity, and also the word karma is used to refer to the entanglement caused by that activity, material activity. You understand? So karma, then what is the fifth topic? Nature, prakriti. So prakriti is material nature, but actually jiva is also part of prakriti. Okay. Prakriti means the nature of the Lord, and that nature is of two types, Paraprakriti and Aparaprakriti. So that includes the material nature and also the spiritual nature, which is the Jiva. Okay. So Ishvara, Prakriti, Jiva, Kala and Karma. So these five topics embody the teachings of Bhagavad Gita. And Srila Vishnu Chakurthi Thakur says that Bhagavad Gita is like a jewel box. Okay. So the upper lid is compared to the last section of Bhagavad Gita. That is the Jnana Yoga section, chapters number 13 to 18. And the lower lid is compared to Karma Yoga, or the first six chapters of Bhagavad Gita. The first section. And the jewel within the box is compared to the middle section of Bhagavad Gita, chapters number 7 to 12, that vividly describe Bhakti Yoga. Okay. So, Gita is thus compared to a jewel box. Okay. So, Gita describes Karma Yoga, Jnana Yoga, Bhakti Yoga. And what is this yoga? Yoga means linking with the Supreme. That is called yoga. And if that linking with the Supreme is predominantly based on fruitive activities, it is called Karma Yoga. And if the linking with the Supreme is based on philosophical analysis and all that, it is called Jnana Yoga. And if the linking is based on meditation on the super soul, it is Ashtanga Yoga. And if that linking with the Supreme is through devotional service of Shravanam, Kirtanam, Smaranam, etc., it is called Bhakti Yoga. All these are yogas only. Okay. So, Bhakti Yoga are the process of rendering devotional service to the Lord in Krishna consciousness is the ultimate perfection of yogas, and it is the essential and conclusive message of Bhagavad Gita. Although Gita describes so many topics, essentially what Krishna recommends for all the readers of Gita or followers of Gita is bhakti, devotional service unto the Supreme. Okay. So, like that, we can discuss a lot about the significance of Bhagavad Gita. And now, just to mention a few points about the significance of Gita, instead of going it very elaborately, taking it very elaborately, we'll say that Bhagavad Gita, the context in which Bhagavad Gita was spoken was the context of a war. You know very well that Pandavas and Kauravas, means the five sons of Pandu and 100 sons of Dhritarashtra, they were brothers. Actually, both of them together can be called Kauravas, but somehow Dhritarashtra never owned his nephews, the Pandavas. So he always kept Pandu's sons separate from his sons. He became very selfish and he wanted the son and all the facilities of the kingdom. He wanted the throne and the kingdom to be given to his own sons, Duryodhan, Dushyasan and others. Right? So he was very partial towards his own sons. So because of this dispute for the kingdom, there were so many tensions between Duryodhan and party and Yudhishthir Maharaj and party. Okay. So finally, even after so many negotiations and there is a peace negotiation which is led by Krishna himself, still Duryodhan was not coming to a compromise. So finally the situation came to war between these two parties. So Kauravas are Duryodhan, Dushyasan, Karna, Shakuni. So all of them were on one side, along with Bhishma and Drona, and Pandavas, Yudhishthir Maharaj, Arjuna, Bhima, Nakula, Sahadev, Drupada Maharaj, Virat Maharaj, all these are one side, along with Krishna supporting them. So thus there was a big war that began around 5000 years back. So then there were in the morning Bhagavatam class, we were discussing all the difficulties that Pandavas went through as a part of our Kunti Maharani prayer section. So Vishan Mahatnehe Purushata Darshanat Asat Sabhayam Vanavasa Kritchrataha. Vishan, so this Duryodhan and party have poisoned Bhima. Mahatnehe, they have set their house on fire. Purushada Darshanat, they also underwent different difficulties due to man-eaters in the jungle. Asat Sabhaya, and Draupadi was insulted, dishonored, and she was being disrobed in the assembly of that gambling, in Hastinapur assembly. And so many other times Pandavas were dealt in a very inappropriate way, and their kingdom was taken away from them in a cheating gambling match. Okay. So like that, so many atrocities happened. The Duryodhan, Dushyasan, Karna, Shakuni, all these people have done a lot of atrocities against the Pandavas. And finally, the situation came to fight, war between both parties. So at that time, just the war was about to begin, and the main warrior on the side of Pandavas, that is Arjuna, Arjuna and Bhima are considered the main warriors on the side of Pandavas. So he became confused. He became bewildered. Is it appropriate to kill my own relatives? Is it appropriate to fight against my own grandfather and guru, Drona and Bhishma? Is it proper for me? So he became bewildered. So in that context, Krishna wanted to enlighten Arjuna with the message of Bhagavad Gita. Now, this message of Bhagavad Gita is spoken in the context of war. But there are hardly any verses about war in this Bhagavad Gita. There may be 10-15 verses, not more than that. Okay. So, the context of this war created a nice situation of suspense for all the readers to follow the message of Bhagavad Gita. But from this war context, Krishna takes the topic to the context of life. Right? So, it goes to a situation where your actual life is being discussed. Right? How to lead life in this world. Karma Yoga, Bhakti Yoga, Jnana Yoga, the science of soul, the three modes of material nature, spiritual world, material world, Paraprakriti, Aparaprakriti, tolerance, equanimity, satisfaction. These are the topics that are discussed throughout the Bhagavad Gita in the context of war. So, now we need to notice one small thing here. That is, Bhagavad Gita is not just a message spoken to inspire Arjuna to fight. When Arjuna was bewildered about his duty, Krishna motivated him and inspired him to do it, this duty in a proper consciousness with detachment and knowledge. Right? So, similarly, in our life, we also get bewildered due to various confusions and other reasons. And someone has to remind us about what is our duty, how to perform our responsibilities in the right spirit. So, for Arjuna, fighting is the duty. For us, something else is the duty. Okay. As students, study is your duty. As managers, managing is their duty. As something else may be the duty. According to designations and different roles that people are playing and different goals that they need to achieve. So, Bhagavad Gita prepares our consciousness to lead our life in a proper manner. And at the same time, Bhagavad Gita brings us out of all the confusions and doubts that we have in our mind. So, Arjuna was bewildered in the beginning of Bhagavad Gita. He says, Karpanya doshopa hata swabhava pruchhamitvam dharma sammoodha chetaha. Dharma sammoodha means I was bewildered. I am bewildered about my duty. And at the end of Bhagavad Gita, Arjuna says that Nashto moha smritir labdha tat prasadan mayachyuta. Arjuna says, I have given up all my doubts and illusion and bewilderment. Tat prasadan maya achyuta. Because of your mercy, I came out of the bewilderment. The beginning of Bhagavad Gita says Arjuna is bewildered about his duty. And the end of Bhagavad Gita says Arjuna came out of that bewilderment. He had no confusions about the performance of his duty. So Bhagavad Gita is that scripture that removes confusions in our mind and brings clarity in our thought. Okay. So Bhagavad Gita brings that clarity. And we can say so many things about the universal relevance of Bhagavad Gita. But with this little background, I would like to begin the first chapter. First chapter. Observing the armies on the battlefield of Kurukshetra. First shloka. Dhritarashtra uvacha. Dharmakshetre Kurukshetre. Samavetayutsavah mamakaha pandavaschaiva kimakurvata sanjaya. So you have Gita Subodhani that will help you to follow the flow. So Dharmakshetri means a place of pilgrimage. What is that place of pilgrimage that Dhritarashtra is referring to in this first shloka? Kurukshetra. Kurukshetra is a very holy place of pilgrimage. Dharmakshetre, Kurukshetre, Samaveta, Yuyutsavaha. All the Pandavas and Duryodhan and other party, so they have assembled there. Samaveta means they have assembled. To do what? Yutsavaha. They are very eager to fight. Yutsavaha. They are eager to fight. Who are they? Mamakaha, my sons. Dhritarashtra is saying this verse. He says, my sons and Pandavas chaiva, Pandu's sons. So he has never treated Yudhishthir and his brothers as his own sons. Instead of thinking that he had 105 sons, he was thinking that I have 100 sons and Pandu has 5 sons. So let me kill these 5 sons so that my 100 sons get the kingdom. When Madri died, her 2 sons, Nakula and Sahadeva, were accepted by Kunti as her own sons. Kunti maintained Nakula and Sahadeva similar to her own sons, Yudhishthir, Bhima and Arjun. You see? So, she never showed any partiality. She always thought, I have 5 sons. But Dhritarashtra could not think that he had 105 sons. He only thought, I have 100 sons. And these 5 sons of Pandu were an obstacle on the path of my sons becoming a king. So he said, Mamakaha Pandavas Chaiva. He has separated Pandu's sons. Kimakurvata Sanjaya. What have they done? What did they do? Now the question seems a bit illogical. He himself said, Samaveta Yutsavaha. They have gathered there desiring to fight. And Dhritarashtra, it's not that he's a new person. He has seen Mahabharata from beginning, even before the birth of Pandavas and Duryodhan and other party. He has already seen, he has been a part of Hastinapur since beginning. So why did they assemble? What are they going to do? He definitely knows. But still, and he himself says also, Samaveta Yutsavaha. They have assembled there, desiring to fight. But still he asks, Kimakurvata Sanjaya? What did they do in the holy land of Kurukshetra? He is asking this question to whom? Sanjaya. Sanjaya was the assistant of Dhritarashtra. And somehow by the mercy of Vyasadev, Sanjaya could envision what happened in the battlefield. He was given a very special vision. Although he is sitting in Hastinapur, still he is able to see what's happening on the battlefield of Kurukshetra. So Sanjaya was narrating the whole situation to Dhritarashtra. So why Dhritarashtra asked this question? After assembling in the holy land of Kurukshetra, what did my sons and sons of Pandu do? Because Dhritarashtra was desirous that his own sons get the kingdom. Okay. But he was doubtful whether they will get the kingdom or not. Because he knew that his sons cannot be victorious ordinarily because they themselves were not righteous. What is dharma and what is adharma? Dhritarashtra has the intelligence to figure out. But still, he was very attached to his own sons. Knowingly, he was doing something wrong. He could never stop Duryodhan's atrocities towards the Pandavas. So, he was desirous that his sons get the kingdom. But he was doubtful whether they will get it or not. Okay. So, why? Because he was fearful because of the holy place there. The holy place, Dharma Kshetra, which is Kurukshetra. So, the holy place of Kurukshetra might have an influence either on the Pandavas or Duryodhan and his brothers. So, because of that, he became doubtful. This question is valid. Although it seems illogical, the question is quite valid. Because of the influence of the holy place, he was fearing that my sons might compromise. Okay? They said, no, we cannot give kingdom to Pandavas back in Hastinapur. But after going to the holy place of Kurukshetra, they might say that, okay, you take your kingdom back. Dhritarashtra never wanted that. You see, he was fearful that his sons might compromise. And he was hopeful that Pandavas can compromise. Pandavas are righteous people. So let them compromise because of the influence of holy place. Let them become compassionate and forgiving and forget their kingdom and then go back, go to the forest and start begging or do something else. So he was hoping that Pandavas should renounce their claim for the kingdom. And he was fearful that his own sons might compromise. He never wanted that to happen. That's why he was doubtful about the son's victory. So that's why he asked this question. You understood? So Dhritarashtra's way of asking this question. Now Prabhupada writes in the purport very beautifully that Bhagavad Gita is the widely read theistic science summarized in the Gita Mahatmya. Ekam Shastram Devaki Putra Gitam, you know that verse. So one should read Bhagavad Gita very scrutinizingly with the help of a person who is a devotee of Krishna. We are reading Bhagavad Gita with the help of Srila Prabhupada's Bhagavad Gita as it is, and Prabhupada is a great devotee of Krishna. Okay. So we need to depend on the Acharya's commentaries, bona fide Acharya's commentaries in a Vaishnava Sampradaya. Then we get the right understanding of Bhagavad Gita. Okay. There may be hundreds of people who might be commenting on Bhagavad Gita, but we need to pick up those explanations which are coming in the line of a bona fide Vaishnava Sampradaya so that our understanding becomes authentic. Okay. So the example of clear understanding is there in the Bhagavad Gita itself, in the way the teaching is understood by Arjuna, who heard Gita directly from the Lord. Okay. And Prabhupada further says about the significance of Dharma Kshetra. We already discussed some of it, some of those points. And Prabhupada mentions a very important and nice point. Although Dhritarashtra was hopeful that his sons gain the kingdom and Pandavas just give up the kingdom, still, Krishna had a plan. We may have hundreds of plans, but Krishna's plan will prevail. God, what is that? Man proposes, God disposes, you see. So what is Krishna's plan? Just like in a paddy field, a farmer will plant rice, but he will uproot grasses and other weeds. Because when weeds are there in a field, they will suck up all the water or fertilizers and other things that are supposed to be nourishing the crops. So a farmer has to pick up the weeds. Similarly, in this Dharma Kshetra, which is like the field to grow Dharma, the weed-like sons of Dhritarashtra have to be uprooted. And who is doing it personally? Krishna. Just like a farmer uproots the weeds and throws them away, similarly, Krishna, in this field of Dharma, Dharma Kshetra, Kuru Kshetra, he uproots the sons of Dhritarashtra headed by Duryodhan and assists the Pandavas to gain victory. Okay, he wants Dharma to prevail, not Adharma. So when Krishna himself has this plan, there is no hope for Duryodhan and Parthi to win. Even if they have most experienced generals like Bhishma and Drona on their side. You see. So this was the question asked by Dhritarashtra in the first verse. And the rest of the chapter is Sanjaya's answer to this question. Is it clear? Sanjaya gives an answer now. So Sanjaya is describing the scene on the battlefield from the second verse. Sanjaya uvacha drishtva tu pandavanikam vyudham duryodhanastada acharyamupasangamya raja vachanam abravit drishtva tu pandavanikam. Duryodhan has seen the army of Pandavas. Drishtvatu Pandavanikam Vyudham Duryodhana. Duryodhana has seen this army of Pandavas. Tada, at the time, Acharyam Upasangamya. He has approached Acharya. Who is that Acharya? Dronacharya. Acharyam Upasangamya Raja Vachanam Abravid. This Raja, Duryodhan Raja, spoke these words. Duryodhan is not yet Raja. Only Dhritarashtra was Raja. But still, Sanjaya is describing Duryodhana as Raja because Duryodhana is expert in Rajaniti. He is expert in politics. Now, after approaching his Acharya, Drona, his teacher, he will speak in a political manner, being a great politician. So, to describe that quality of being a politician, he is described to be a politician. King, Raja, Vachanamabravit. Okay. So, Dhritarashtra was blind from birth. Okay. And he knows that his own sons are also blind in the matter of dharma from birth. So Duryodhana is physically blind. Dhritarashtra is physically blind and Duryodhana is blind to dharma. Even Dhritarashtra, although he understands dharma, but he has a soft corner, he has a lot of attachment, not just soft corner. He has a lot of undue attachment towards his own son. So he is supporting adharma, knowing what is dharma. Okay. So, he knows that Dhritarashtra was bereft of vision and spiritual vision also. And he knew well that his sons were also equally blind in the matter of religion. So, he was sure his sons could never compromise with the Pandavas. Okay. Now, Sanjaya is describing. What did Duryodhana speak after approaching Acharya, Drona? He says, Pashyaitam Panduputranam Acharya Mahatim Chamum Vyudham Drupada Putrena Tapasishyena Dhimata Pashyaitam Panduputranam. After seeing this Panduputras, Pandavas army, Acharya Mahatim Chamum. Mahati is great. Chamu is military force. So, Duryodhan is requesting Dronacharya. Pashya etan. Look at this great army. Pashya etan. Panduputranam. Acharya Mahatim Chamum. Oh, Acharya. Oh, Dronacharya. Please see this great military force arranged by Panduputras. Okay, who helped them arrange this? He says, Vyudham Drupada Putrena, the son of Drupada Maharaj. Who is that? Drishtadyumna has arranged this. Vyudham Drupada Putrena. And who is that Drupada Putra? Tavasishyena Dhimata. He is your own intelligent disciple. And Duryodhan was being sarcastic here. And Duryodhan wanted to invoke the anger of Dronacharya in this verse. He did not use the word Drishtadyumna. He used the word Drupada Putrena because Dronacharya and Drupada, they both had a quarrel earlier. They both studied under the same guru. But Drona was a Brahmana and Drupada was a Kshatriya. So after they finished their education in the Gurukul, Drupada went back to his kingdom and he became the king. And Dronacharya started living his household life as a simple Brahman, but he had some financial difficulties. So he approached Drupada Maharaj and asked, can you please help me financially? Can you please give me a cow so that I can maintain my son properly? I am in a great financial crisis. And Drupada did not help this Brahmana Drona, and further he even insulted also. Then later, as time progressed, Dronacharya went to Hastinapur. He became the teacher of the 5 Pandavas and the 100 sons of Dhritarashtra, and he started teaching them military science, and he was well established, and he found his best disciple. Who is that? Arjun. He had sent his best disciple Arjun to go and defeat Drupada, and Arjun went and defeated Drupada. Okay, and Drupada became so ashamed. Okay, so Drupada's revengeful attitude towards Drona increased. He did a sacrifice to get a son who can kill Dronacharya. And that son was Drishtadyumna. And this Drishtadyumna was personally trained by Dronacharya himself. సో ద్రోణాచార్య నోస్ దట్ ధృష్టద్యుమ్న వాస్ బోర్న్ టు కిల్ హిమ్సెల్ఫ్ కిమ్ కిల్ హిమ్ కిల్ ద్రోణ బట్ బీయింగ్ ఎ వెరీ లిబరల్ బ్రాహ్మణ ఎ బ్రాహ్మణ షుడ్ నాట్ హెసిటేట్ టు గివ్ నాలెడ్జ్ టు ఎ క్వాలిఫైడ్ పర్సన్ ఎ క్వాలిఫైడ్ క్షత్రియ లైక్ ధృష్టద్యుమ్న ఇస్ ఆస్కింగ్ అండ్ బెగింగ్ ఫర్ నాలెడ్జ్ మిలిటరీ నాలెడ్జ్ సో ఇట్ వాస్ రెస్పాన్సిబిలిటీ ఆఫ్ ద్రోణాచార్య టు గివ్ దట్ నాలెడ్జ్ ఈవెన్ ఇఫ్ హీ నోస్ దట్ దిస్ ధృష్టద్యుమ్న ఇస్ గోయింగ్ టు కిల్ మీ ఈస్ బాండ్ టు కిల్ మీ ఈస్ డెస్టిన్డ్ టు కిల్ మీ బట్ బ్రాహ్మణ షుడ్ నాట్ హెసిటేట్ సో ద్రోణాచార్య బీయింగ్ ఎ వెరీ లిబరల్ బ్రాహ్మణ హీ హెస్ గివెన్ ఆల్ ఎడ్యుకేషన్ టు ధృష్టద్యుమ్న యు సి సో దుర్యోధన్ బై యూజింగ్ ద వర్డ్ వ్యూఢాం ద్రుపద పుత్రేణ తవ శిష్యేణ ధీమత సో ఇండైరెక్ట్లీ హీ ఇండికేటెడ్ హీ రిమైండెడ్ ద్రోణ ఆఫ్ ఆల్ ది ప్రీవియస్ ఇన్సిడెంట్స్ హీ నెవర్ యూజ్డ్ ద వర్డ్ ధృష్టద్యుమ్న హీ వాజ్ యూజింగ్ ద వర్డ్ ద్రుపద పుత్ర టు ఇన్వోక్ యాంగర్ ఇన్ ద్రోణ బై రిమైండింగ్ హిమ్ ఆఫ్ ద ప్రీవియస్ ఎనిమిటీ విత్ ద్రుపద ఓకే అండ్ తవ శిష్యేణ ధీమత He is your disciple. Means you have very liberally and leniently gave all education to this Drishtadyumna. And with that education, he is standing against you. Pandavas are fighting against you and he is supporting them. And he is going to kill you. Or he is born to kill you. Okay. So your disciple. And Pandavas also arranged this great army. He says that in the first line. పశ్చైతాం పాండుపుత్రాణ ఆచార్య మహతీం చుమం పాండవస్ హవ్ అరేంజ్డ్ ఎ గ్రేట్ ఆర్మీ హియర్ టు ఫైట్ అగేన్స్ట్ యూ సో హీఈస్ ఇండైరెక్ట్లీ ఇండికేటింగ్ దట్ యువర్ డిసైపుల్ ధృష్టద్యుమ్న అండ్ యువర్ డిసైపుల్స్ పాండవస్ ఆర్ స్టాండింగ్ అగేన్స్ట్ యూఆర్ దేర్ టీచర్ సో బికమ్ యాంగ్రీ అండ్ ఫైట్ విత్ దెమ్ హౌ కెన్ ఎ టీచర్ బి ఛాలెంజ్డ్ by a disciple, by a student. So he's invoking anger. And at the same time, he's also saying, earlier you have become so lenient in giving knowledge to Drishtadyumna, but now in the war, you should not become lenient and start showing your affection towards the Pandavas or Drishtadyumna. You should fight valorously. See, they have arranged a military army. They're standing against you. Like that, in a very political manner, Duryodhan is instigating the anger in Dronacharya. Now, in the next sloka, fourth verse, Duryodhan says, Atra Shura Maheshwasa Bhima Arjuna Samayudhi Yudhano Viratascha Drupadascha Maharatha And Duryodhan is now describing the army of the Pandavas. Okay, earlier he said, in the third verse he said, look at this army arranged by Pandavas and your disciple Drishtadyumna. Now he says, he counts the warriors in that army. Atra Sura Maheshwasa Bhima Arjuna Samayudhi. In that army there are so many great fighters who are equal in strength to Bhima and Arjuna. Because on the side of Pandavas, Bhima and Arjuna are considered the most powerful warriors. Bhima, in his one arm, has 10,000 elephants' strength. Okay? So, in one arm, he has the strength of 10,000 elephants. One devotee was saying that, what does it mean? You keep 10,000 elephants in a line, Bhima would punch the first elephant, and the 10,000th elephant in the line will fall down. You can just imagine what happens to the first, second, third elephants, right? If the 10,000th elephant is falling down, what happened to first elephant, you just decide. So, Bhima Arjuna Samayudhi, and Arjuna is not a lesser fighter. He got the Gandiva bow, he mesmerized Indra and Shiva, he received Pashupatastra from Shiva. And he defeated Nivata Kavachas and he impressed Mayadhanava like that. Arjuna is a very powerful and popular warrior at that time who got so many military certificates. Proposes like this. Arjuna got so many military certificates. Just like you have awards, right? Awards and certificates. Like that Arjuna got military certificates. He's a very powerful warrior. So Bhima Arjuna Samayudhi. If at all Duryodhan has to be defeated, that would be primarily by Bhima and Arjuna. And if he has to win, that would be primarily by Bhishma and Drona. So these are the prominent warriors on either side. So Yuyudhana Viratascha, and there are other people like Yuyudhana, Virata, Drupada, Drupadascha Maharatha. All these people are Maharathis. Okay. Next, Drishtaketuscha Kitanah, Kashirajascha Viryavan, Purujit Kunti Bhojascha, Shaibhyascha Narapungavah. So Drishtaketu, Chekitana, Kashi Raja, and all these people are very powerful people, Viryavan, Purujit, Kunti Bhoja, Shaibhya, all these people are best amongst men, they are like kings, so they are supporting the Pandavas army. He described those names and is continuing to describe. Yudhamanyuscha Vikranta, Uttamaujascha Viryavan, Subhadro Draupadeyascha, Sarva Eva Maharathaha. He is giving further names. Okay. Yudhamanyu, Uttamauja, son of Subhadra, who is Abhimanyu, and sons of Draupadi, they were also there on the battlefield. All these warriors are great chariot fighters. So they are Maharathis. They can fight on chariot. There are some fighters who are fighting on the, they are like foot soldiers. Okay. Some people fight sitting on the top of a horse. Some people on elephants. But there are some people who are on the chariots with a chariot driver. They are like very powerful warriors. Right. Sarva eva maharatha. So like that, in the 3rd, 4th, 5th and 6th, these 4 verses, Duryodhan described the army of the Pandavas. Okay. So by describing the army of Pandavas, Duryodhan wanted to increase the anger of Drona, that Pandavas were standing against Drona now. Okay. And Duryodhan also was being fearful in describing this army. Right, he feared internally seeing the Pandavas army. Suddenly he goes in front of the teacher and then starts describing the enemy's army. That indicates a lot of fear in his heart. You see, Duryodhan was not fearless. But being a diplomatic politician, he was hiding the fear. Okay. And he was being very confident in front of Dronacharya. And that confidence is expressed in the next verses. 7th to 9th verses. In these 3 verses, Duryodhan describes his own army. Because Dronacharya, Duryodhan went and described the army of Pandavas, Dronacharya might perceive some fear in the heart of Duryodhan. So to hide that fear and to exhibit some kind of confidence and fearlessness, Duryodhan started describing his own army now. He says in the 7th verse. Asmakam tu visishtaye tanni bodhadvijottamam nayaka mama sainyasya samnyartham tan bravimite. Asmakam tu visishtaye, I just described their army. That does not mean our army is any useless or any less. Okay, asmakam tu visishtaye tan nibodha dvijottama. I am going to speak about our own army. Oh, Dvijottama. Oh, best of all, Brahmanas, Drona. Please listen. Okay. Nayaka mama sainyasya. There are so many leaders and warriors in my own sainya, my own army. Samnyartham tan bravimite. Okay. For your information, I am just speaking about them. Now he starts speaking. What is that? Bhavan bhishmasya karanasya. Kripascha samitin jayaha Ashwatthama vikarnascha Saumadattista thaivacha. He starts enumerating the prominent warriors on his side. He says, Bhavan. First he says, Bhavan. Bhava means yourself, your good self. Who is that? Dronacharya. In my army, you are there personally, Bhavan. And who is there? Who else is there? Bhishmascha, Karanascha, కృపశ్చ సమితింజయ. సో ద్రోణ, భీష్మ, కర్ణ, కృప, దీస్ ఆర్ ది ప్రామినెంట్ వారియర్స్ దట్ దుర్యోధన్ డిస్క్రైబ్స్ రైట్ ఇన్ ద బిగినింగ్. ఓకే, నెక్స్ట్ హీ సేస్ అశ్వత్థామ ఇస్ ఆల్సో దేర్, ద్రోణస్సన్. వికర్ణశ్చ, వై హీ సేయింగ్ వికర్ణ? వికర్ణ ఇస్ వన్ ఆఫ్ హిస్ 99 బ్రదర్స్. వికర్ణ ఇస్ నాట్ ఎ వెరీ గ్రేట్ వారియర్ హూ కెన్ బి కౌంటెడ్ అలాంగ్ విత్ భీష్మ, ద్రోణ అండ్ కర్ణ. బట్ స్టిల్ హీ టుక్ ద నేమ్ ఆఫ్ వికర్ణ బికాస్ వికర్ణ వాజ్ ఆల్సో హీరింగ్ దిస్ హోల్ టాక్ బై దుర్యోధన్. వికర్ణ ఇస్ దట్ వన్ పర్సన్ హూ స్పోక్ అగేన్స్ట్ దుర్యోధన వెన్ హీ టుక్ ద డెసిషన్ ఆఫ్ డిస్రోబింగ్ ద్రౌపది ఇన్ దట్ అసెంబ్లీ. యు సీ, వికర్ణ స్టార్టెడ్ స్పీకింగ్ ఇన్ ఫేవర్ ఆఫ్ ది పాండవ, దే యూ షుడ్ నాట్ ఇన్సల్ట్ ఎ ఉమెన్ లైక్ దిస్, రైట్? షీ ఈస్ ఆఫ్టర్ ఆల్ అవర్ ఓన్ ఫ్యామిలీ మెంబర్, యూ కెనాట్ ఇన్సల్ట్ లైక్ దట్. సో హీ సెడ్ ఇన్ సపోర్టింగ్ ద్రౌపది. సో దుర్యోధన్ బీయింగ్ ఎ డిప్లొమాటిక్ పర్సన్, సో హీ ఈస్ ట్రయింగ్ టు కౌంట్ వికర్ణ ఆల్సో అమాంగ్స్ ది గ్రేట్ వారియర్స్ సో దట్ వికర్ణ జస్ట్ స్టేస్ విత్ హిమ్, రైట్? హీ డజంట్ అగైన్ అపోజ్ దుర్యోధన్. ఓకే, అశ్వత్థామ వికర్ణశ్చ సోమదత్తి తథైవ చ. సోమదత్త ఇస్ ఆల్సో దేర్, హీస్ ఆల్సో కాల్డ్ భూరిశ్రవ. నెక్స్ట్ 9th వర్స్. అన్యే చ బహవః శూరా మదర్థే త్యక్త జీవిత నానాశస్త్ర ప్రహరణాః సర్వే యుద్ధ విశారదాః. అన్యే చ బహవః శూరా, దేర్ ఆర్ సో మెనీ అదర్ శూరా గ్రేట్ వారియర్స్ ఆల్సో. మదర్థే త్యక్త జీవితాః, ఫర్ మై సేక్ they are ready to give up their lives also. Madarthe tyakta jeevitaah. Prabhupada says very interestingly in the purport, Duryodhan was trying to indicate that these people are so dedicated to me, but indirectly he had already said that because of taking my side all these warriors are going to lose their lives. Madarthe tyakta jeevitaah, because of taking Duryodhan's side they are anyways going to die, Prabhupada says in the purport. సో నానా శస్త్ర ప్రహరణాః సర్వే యుద్ధ విశారదాః, దే ఆర్ వెల్ వెర్స్డ్ విత్ సో మెనీ శస్త్ర, సో మెనీ వెపన్స్, అండ్ సర్వే యుద్ధ విశారదాః, దే ఆర్ వెరీ ఎక్స్పర్ట్ ఇన్ దిస్ యుద్ధ ఫైటింగ్ బ్యాటిల్స్, దే ఆర్ ఆల్రెడీ ఎక్స్పీరియన్స్డ్ ఇన్ అదర్ బ్యాటిల్స్ ఆల్సో. నెక్స్ట్ హీ సేస్ అపర్యాప్తం తదస్మాకం ఫలం భీమ భీష్మాభిరక్షితం పర్యాప్తం త్విదమే త్వేషాం బలం భీమాభిరక్షితం. సో ఇన్ దట్ సెక్షన్, సబ్ సెక్షన్ 3rd to 6th వర్సెస్, దుర్యోధన్ డిస్క్రైబ్డ్ పాండవస్ ఆర్మీ, అండ్ ఇన్ ద 7th, 8th and 9th వర్సెస్ Duryodhan described his own army. In the 10th and 11th verses, he is making a comparison between these two armies. Okay? Now, in the 10th verse, he says, Aparyaptam tadasmakam balam bhishmabhirakshitam. Aparyaptam means immeasurable, unlimited. Okay? So, our army is immeasurable, being protected by the great strength of Bhishma. Balam Bhishma Bhirakshitam. Bhishma is protecting our army, and our army is immeasurable. In numbers also, Duryodhan's army is more compared to Arjuna's army or Yudhishthir's army. And Paryaptam Tvidame Desham Balam Bhima Bhirakshitam. So Bhima's army is and Pandava's army is protected by Bhima. He is the most powerful warrior there. And that is paryaptam, that is insufficient. Our army is immeasurable, their army is insufficient. Okay, their army is limited. He says like that. But this aparyaptam and paryaptam words can have other meanings also. Okay, what are they? So, measurable is, immeasurable is aparyaptam. But the paryaptam could mean sufficient. Aparyaptam could mean insufficient. Our army ఆల్దో ప్రొటెక్టెడ్ బై భీష్మ ఈస్ ఇన్సఫిషియంట్ టు గెయిన్ విక్టరీ ఫర్ అస్ బట్ దేర్ ఆర్మీ ప్రొటెక్టెడ్ బై భీమ ఈస్ సఫిషియంట్ ఫర్ దెమ్ టు గెయిన్ విక్టరీ ఓకే దట్ అపర్యాప్తం పర్యాప్తం వర్డ్స్ కెన్ హ్యావ్ అదర్ మీనింగ్స్ ఆల్సో ఓకే సో హీ సేస్ హీ ఫర్దర్ సేస్ దట్ భీమ ఈజ్ ఆల్సో ఎ గ్రేట్ వారియర్ బట్ ఇన్ ఫ్రంట్ ఆఫ్ భీష్మ Bhima is not very glorious. So Arjuna wanted to indicate. Prabhupada describes, Duryodhan was always envious of Bhima because he knew perfectly well that he, if he should die at all, that must be in the hands of Bhima only. Only Bhima can kill Duryodhan. And there is a special envy towards Bhima that Duryodhan is holding in his heart. So he described Bhima. 11th shloka. Anyeshu ayaneshu cha sarveshu యథా భాగం అవస్థితః భీష్మమేవాభిరక్షంతు భవంతః సర్వ ఏవ హి అయనేషు చ సర్వేషు యథా భాగం అవస్థితః సో ఆల్ ఆఫ్ యు నౌ దుర్యోధన్ ప్రపోజ్ ఎక్స్ప్లెయిన్స్ వెరీ వండర్ఫుల్ ఇన్ ద పర్పోర్ట్ దుర్యోధన్ మస్ట్ బి థింకింగ్ దట్ అరే I have glorified Bhishma so much. Earlier he began describing his army with Drona first. Bhavan Bhishmascha Karnascha. What is that verse? 8th verse. In the 8th verse he said Bhavan. Dronacharya's name he took first. Then he spoke about Bhishma. Because a Brahmana should be given first respects, then a Kshatriya can be respected. Bhishma was a Kshatriya and Drona was a Brahmana. So he took the name of Brahmana first. Okay. Although Bhishma is a great warrior. But later he brought the focus to Bhishma. Okay. So he said Bhishma is a great warrior. Our entire army is being protected by the expertise of Bhishma only. But because he praised Bhishma so much, then he is again coming back to other warriors. That, oh, Bhishma is very old. He may be absorbed in fighting with the enemies and the enemy may take advantage of Bhishma's absorption in fight and he might attack Bhishma in a different way. So all of you should sit in your strategic locations and give special protection to Bhishma. He's telling other people. So our victory is dependent on Bhishma. At the same time, all of you also should protect Bhishma. Okay. అయనేషు చ సర్వేషు యథా భాగం అవస్థితాః సో ఆల్ ఆఫ్ యూ షుడ్ జస్ట్ స్టే ఇన్ యువర్ స్ట్రాటజిక్ లొకేషన్స్ అండ్ గివ్ ప్రొటెక్షన్ టు భీష్మ భీష్మమేవాభిరక్షంతు భవంతః సర్వ ఏవ హి అదర్ వారియర్స్ షుడ్ నాట్ ఫీల్ దెమ్సెల్స్ వెరీ లెస్ ఇంపార్టెంట్ ఇఫ్ భీష్మ ఇస్ గ్లోరిఫైడ్ సో మచ్ సో దట్ ఈస్ ద ఇంటెన్షన్ ఆఫ్ దుర్యోధన్ సో అట్ ఎవ్రీ పాయింట్ హీఈస్ యూజింగ్ డిప్లొమసీ If it's a plain glorification, he doesn't have to think so much. Okay? But because he's... In fact, Bhishma and Drona themselves are not favorable of fighting on the side of Duryodhan. But they were obliged to fight. Okay? And Duryodhan, Prabhupada writes in the purports, that Duryodhan was also confident about the support of Bhishma and Drona because they did not speak a single word when Draupadi was being disrobed. Okay? They did not protest against Duryodhan so much. So Prabhupada writes in the purport that he was confident of the full support of Bhishma and Dronacharya in the battle because he knew very well they did not speak a word when Arjuna's wife Draupadi is in helpless condition, had appealed to them for justice while she was being forced to appear naked in the presence of all great generals in the assembly. So just like they supported me earlier, let them support me now also. And it's an obligatory support. It is not a support which is heartfelt. A heartfelt support will be accepted by sane people. But if such people recognize that the other person is not inspired enough to support me, they don't want to forcefully extract that service from them. But a wicked person like Duryodhan, although he knows very well that Drona and Bhishma are not very much in favor of him, but still he is shamelessly trying to take support from them. And he even is depending on them for his own victory. That is Duryodhan's selfish mentality. He was so obsessed with the desire for kingdom. He just wants to sit on the throne. That's all. But he could never sit on the throne. So it was meant for Yudhishthir Maharaj. But Duryodhan was very greedy to sit on the throne. Anyways, so that completes one section where the first verse describes Dhritarashtra's question to Sanjaya about the scene on the battlefield. The second verse begins Sanjaya's description of what happened on the battlefield. In the third, fourth, fifth and sixth verses, Duryodhan describes the Pandavas army. In the 7th, 8th and 9th verses, Duryodhan describes his own army. In the 10th and 11th verses, Duryodhan compares both the armies. Now we'll come to the 12th verse. So from 12th verse onwards, we see how the conscience were being blown. And indirectly, all these conscience, directly, not indirectly, all these blowing of conscience were declaring victory for the Pandavas. They were all signs of victory for the Pandavas. We'll describe this also in this section. 12th verse. Tasya sanjanayam harsham kuru vruddha pitamaha simhanadam vinatyauchehi shankham dadmau pratapavan tasya sanjanayam harsham kuru vruddha pitamaha. So after Duryodhan gave this long speech in front of Drona, Bhishma and all the other chief generals in his army, Bhishma did not speak a single word. He immediately commenced the war by blowing the conch shell. So blowing the conch shell indicates commencement of war. So to encourage his despondent or anxious grandson, Bhishma immediately started blowing conch shell. Simhanadam vinatyauscha. Okay, he made sound by blowing conch shell. Bhishma made sound like a roaring lion. Simhanadam vinatyauscha. Shankhau tadmau pratapavan. Pratapavan means one who has a lot of pratap. Very valiant, very courageous, very powerful warrior. He started blowing his conch shell. Actually, you hear blowing of conch shell in our temples. Vrindavan Vihari temple six times. And we have Madan Mohan temple also. We have all these Vrindavan temples here. And Giriraj. So we blow conch shell several times. At least 20-30 times within our campus. And all this blowing of conch shells indicate the beginning of Vishnu worship. Bhishma was blowing conch shell now. So that was indicating that he is just beginning his devotional service to Krishna. So he is beginning his Vishnu worship by blowing the conch shell. So, and that only indicates that Duryodhan is going to be defeated. So out of natural compassion for his grandson, just to cheer him up, he blew conch shell very loudly. Indirectly, by the symbolism of the conch shell, he informed his depressed grandson Duryodhan that he had no chance of victory in the battle because the Supreme Lord Krishna was on the other side. Krishna was not only on the other side of the army, Krishna is there on this side also within the heart of Bhishma. Bhishma was carrying Krishna within his heart. Okay. And to fulfill Krishna's desire to give a lesson to this world, that however powerful a great general may be, even though he is as powerful as Bhishma, if he takes the side of a wrong party, he has to be defeated. Krishna wanted to prove this to the world, and Bhishma is cooperating with him. And also Bhishma was a very pure devotee of the Lord who is in the Virya Rasa. So, Krishna, Bhishma's worship of Vishnu or Krishna He's not just with some flowers. Okay, I'll offer flowers. I'll do some puja. He may do that also, no problem. But he worships Krishna through arrows. Right? Because he's in Virya Rasa. So someone who is in Shringara Rasa, or Dasya Rasa, or Vatsalya Rasa, they worship Krishna in different manners. A Vatsalya Bhakta may feed some food to Krishna very lovingly with a lot of affection. Somebody who is in Shringara Rasa or Madhurya Rasa, so they may worship Krishna with flowers and all that. Dasya Rasa, they may do some other services, right, menial services. But he is in Virya Rasa, right? So he worships Krishna with arrows. And he is beginning his worship now by blowing conch. So, but still, although he was not very much in favor of Duryodhan's mentality, still it was his duty to conduct the fight. So no pains would be spared in that connection. So he began the fight. Tatashankhascha bhiryascha పణవానక గోముఖాః సహసైవాభ్యనన్యంత సశబ్దః స్తుములో భవత్. సో వెన్ భీమ బ్లూ హిస్ కాన్షెల్, దేర్ ఆర్ సో మెనీ అదర్ వారియర్స్ అండ్ అదర్ పీపుల్ ఇన్ ద బ్యాటిల్ ఫీల్డ్, దే ఆల్సో స్టార్టెడ్ బ్లోయింగ్ దేర్ కాన్షెల్స్ అండ్ కెటిల్ డ్రమ్స్ అండ్ బ్యూగిల్స్ అండ్ దే మేడ్ ఎ టుమల్టియస్ సౌండ్ మార్కింగ్ ద బిగినింగ్ ఆఫ్ ద వార్. So when conchal is blown means the war began. Okay. 14th verse. Tatah svetair hayair yukte mahatisyandane sthitau madhavah pandavaschaiva divyau shankhau prathatmatuhu tatah svetair hayair yukte. So far, Sanjaya described what's happening on the side of Duryodhan's army. Now, he shifted the camera towards Pandava's side. What's happening there? Tata hashvetair hayair yukte. On a beautiful chariot. Mahatishyandane sthitav. Mahatishyandana means on a great chariot. Krishna and Arjuna were sitting. And this great chariot was being drawn by white horses. Okay. Svetair hayair yukte mahatishyandane sthitav. Sthitav means they are situated. Who are they? Madhavah pandavaschaiva. Madhava refers to Krishna. Pandava refers to Arjuna. Okay. So, pandavaschaiva. Divyau shankhau prathatmatuhu. They started blowing their divya shankha. Means very transcendental conscience. This fly is disturbing so much. It's okay, no need. So, Bhishma blew his conchal. Similarly, Krishna and Arjuna also blew their conchals. But there is a difference in the quality of this blowing. Quality of their conchals also. Prabhupada indicates that immediately. In contrast with the conchal blown by Bhishma Dev, the conchals in the hands of Krishna and Arjuna are described as transcendental. Divyau shankhau. Okay. Bhishma's conchal was not described to be Divyau shankha. He's on the side of Duryodhan. Although he's a pure devotee, of course. That doesn't mean, you don't have to minimize the position of Bhishma in any way. But Arjuna is on the side of Krishna. Or Krishna is on the side of Arjuna. Their conchals were very brilliant. Very transcendental. Jayastu pandu putranam yesham pakshe janardhanaha. Prabhupada writes this Sanskrit phrase there. Jayastu pandu putranam. The sons of Pandu will definitely become victorious. Why? Yesham pakshe janardhanaha. On their side, Janardana, Krishna is personally sitting. So definitely they will win. That is clear. So whoever is on the side of Krishna, or when Krishna is on the side of someone, that party has to become victorious. And why? Because Krishna is the husband of Goddess of Fortune. He is called Madhava. Okay, the word Madhava is described. Madhava means that Lord who is the husband of Goddess of Fortune. When Krishna is on the side of Pandavas, So goddess of fortune will also be on the side of Pandavas. So all fortune will be there for the Pandavas. Okay. Next, 15th shloka. The 15th and 16th shlokas give us the names of the conch shells blown by Krishna and Pandavas. Okay. What is that? Panchajanyam Hrishikesho,
Panchajanyam Hrishikesho,
Devadattam Dhananjayah,
Devadattam Dhananjayah,
Paundram Dadmau Mahashankham,
Paundram Dadmau Mahashankham,
Bhimakarma Vrukodarah,
Bhimakarma Vrukodarah,
Panchajanyam Hrishikesho, Devadattam Dhananjayah. Hrishikesha means Krishna's conch shell is called Panchajanya. Krishna is called Hrishikesha because he is the owner of all senses. Right? He is the director of all senses. And he especially directs the senses of those people who are surrendered unto him. So in this context, Krishna is going to direct the senses of Arjuna. So that's why he is described with the name Hrishikesha. Okay. So Panchajanyam Hrishikesha Devadattam Dhananjaya. Dhananjaya means one who conquers wealth. And this is the name of Arjuna. Arjuna is described as Dhananjaya because he helped his elder brother Yudhishthir to gain wealth for various sacrifices. He is also called Dhananjaya. And he blew his conch shell named Devadatta. And Paundrav Dadvam Mahashankam Bhimakarma Vrukodaraha. Vrukodara is Bhima. Means Bhima is the performer of Herculean tasks. He eats a lot, he works a lot. That's why he's called Vrukodara. So he blew a conch shell named Paundra. Okay. So Prabhupada writes in the purport about the significance of all these names. Okay. So many names Krishna Prabhupada describes about Madhusudana, Govinda, Vasudeva, Devaki Nandana, Yashoda Nandana. Means when Krishna performs some activities, he gets a name. All the names of the Supreme Lord are dependent on his qualities or activities. Okay. In this world, the name of a person and the person's personal attributes and qualities may not match often. But in Krishna's case, in the Supreme Lord's case, his qualities and his activities match with his names. Okay. He appeared as the son of Vasudev. He is called Vasudev. Okay. Like that, there are so many other names. 16th verse. Ananta Vijayam Raja.
Ananta Vijayam Raja.
Kunti Putro Yudhishthirah.
Kunti Putro Yudhishthirah.
Nakulah Sahadevascha.
Sughoshamani Pushpakau.
Ananta Vijayam Raja. Raja is referring to Yudhishthir Maharaj. Yudhishthir Maharaj blew his conch shell named Ananta Vijaya. Next, Kunti Putro Yudhishthiraha. Okay. The person who blew this conch shell named Ananta Vijaya is mentioned there. Nakulah Sahadevascha Sughoshamani Pushpakau. Nakula and Sahadeva blew their conch shells, which are named Sughosha and Manipushpaka respectively. Clear? Six conch shells are blown by these six people. Krishna and the five Pandavas. Okay. So, Kashyascha Parameshvasaha. Kashyascha Parameshvasaha.
Kashyascha Parameshvasaha.
Shikhandicha Maharathaha.
Shikhandicha Maharathaha.
Drishtadyumno Virataschya.
Drishtadyumno Virataschya.
Satyakischa Parajitaha.
Satyakischa Parajitaha.
Drupado Draupadeyascha.
Drupado Draupadeyascha.
Sarvashah Prithivipate.
Sarvashah Prithivipate.
Saubhadrascha Mahabahu.
Saubhadrascha Mahabahu.
Shankhan Dadmau Prithak Prithak.
Shankhan Dadmau Prithak Prithak.
So just as Pandavas and Krishna blew their conch shells, there are so many other great warriors like Kashi Raja, Shikhandi, Drishtadyumna, Virata, Satyaki, Drupada, and sons of Draupadi and Abhimanyu, all of them blew their respective conch shells. Okay. And this whole scene was being described by Sanjaya to Dhritarashtra. So Dhritarashtra very tactfully sorry, Sanjaya informed Dhritarashtra very tactfully by using the word Divyo Shankhav in the 14th verse. They are transcendental conscience. So, by the blowing of all these conch shells, the victory was indicated for the Pandavas. So many conch shells were being blown. So, it's indicated that the Kuru dynasty would be killed in the great battle, and his unlawful policy to deceive the Pandavas wasn't very laudable. So, Sanjaya indicated to Dhritarashtra in this way. So, because Dhritarashtra, if he wanted, he could have controlled his sons. But he never stopped his sons. He encouraged his sons. So, when the father is not stopping the nefarious activities of his sons, so he also participates, he also should accept the responsibility of their sinful activities. Okay. So, once Krishna directly suggested Dhritarashtra, and Krishna earlier he had sent Akrura to enlighten Dhritarashtra. A king is supposed to treat all his citizens equally. Citizens are Praja. Praja means not only human beings, animals also. So, a king is supposed to give protection to all the citizens, all the Praja in his kingdom with an equal vision. Okay. So, if that is the responsibility of a king, what to speak of treating his sons and his nephews on an equal plane? As a king, Dhritarashtra was supposed to treat all the citizens equally, but he was unable to treat his 100 sons and the 5 sons of his brother equally. That was his weakness. So, Akrura mentioned this to Dhritarashtra and said, you are being very partial towards your own sons. You are supposed to give protection to Pandavas. Instead of giving protection, you are even trying to kill them. It's not appropriate on your part. So you are supposed to treat everyone equally. So like that, Akrura very mildly given advice to Dhritarashtra. But you know what Dhritarashtra said? He said, my dear Akrura, your instructions are brilliant. They are as shining as the lightning in the sky. But how long does lightning stay in the sky? For hardly a moment. Just one flash will come within less than a second and it will disappear. So the lightning comes in the clouds and it does not stay for more than a moment. Similarly, the lightning like powerful advices or instructions of Dhritarashtra, Akrura cannot stay in the cloud-like heart of Dhritarashtra for more than a second. I appreciate what you say, but my weakness is I cannot follow what you say. Dhritarashtra honestly admitted. Why? Because I am very attached to my son. My attachment, my undue attachment towards my son is not allowing me to be equal towards my brother's sons. He admitted it. And you know how he said it, how he put it? He said, things are already set up by destiny. So, there is very little thing that I can do now. I cannot do anything to rectify the situation now. Whatever happens, let it happen. By Krishna's will, by God's will. But the problem is, and Dhritarashtra is very well aware that Krishna is the Supreme Personality of Godhead. He even offers a brilliant prayer to Krishna in the 10th canto. I think it was in 48th chapter somewhere. 48th or 49th chapter you can see. Akrura meets Dhritarashtra in Hastinapur. Very beautiful chapter. You can read in Krishna book also. Correct. Of course, before this war. So, point is, Dhritarashtra could not take a proper decision at the right time. And he is saying that it is because of the destiny. Destiny is not your decision. Destiny is the result of your decision. When you have a choice to make, when you can choose A or B, you have consciously chosen A, and then you can't claim that it is destiny. Whatever are the consequences of choosing your option A is the destiny. But your choice of A is not your destiny. That is based on your own free will. When we use or misuse our free will, we create a destiny for ourselves. Okay. Our actions are not destiny. Reactions to our conscious actions is the destiny. So Duryodhan could have rectified the mentality of Dhritarashtra could have stopped Duryodhan to behave in this way, but he could not do it. And he says it's all destiny. Your decision making is also destiny. Then where is the question of free will? So by using or misusing our free will, we create a destiny. We cannot make a wrong decision consciously and then say that this is also destiny. Okay. You chose to jump from the cliff. So that is not your destiny. That is your choice. But once you made that choice and then you started jumping from the mountain cliff, your head will break or hand will break. That is not in your hands. That is destiny. You understand? So while jumping, when you are traveling from the top of the cliff to the ground level, you may take half minute or 10 seconds or 20 seconds. During that time, you can remember Krishna, you can remember Maya, you can do something else. That is your in your free will. Right? At every point, we have some free will. And the result of our utility of free will is destiny. Our utilization of free will itself cannot be called destiny, technically speaking. But of course, sometimes we use our free will also because of our previous impressions. Okay? And those impressions are also created by our use or misuse of our free will earlier. So ultimately, it boils down to we making a conscious choice. Okay? So our current conscious choices create our thought process in future also, create the reactions to our actions also in future. And that also can be called destiny. But our utilization of free will cannot be called destiny. Okay? Fine. The last verse in this today's session, 19th verse. Saghosho Dhartarashtranam Hridayani Vyadarayat Nabhascha Prithivim Chaiva Tumulo Abhyanunadayan. So Saghosho Dhartarashtranam. Saghosho means the ghosha or the sound created by the conch shells of Pandavas and party, created Hridayani Vyadarayat, that shattered the hearts of people on the side of Duryodhan. Nabhascha Prithivim Chaiva Tumulo Bhyanunathayat. So vibrating both in the sky and the earth, it shattered the hearts of the sons of Dhritarashtra. So the blowing of these conch shells on Pandava side became very uproarious. That created a tumultuous sound that caused fear in the hearts of people who are siding Duryodhan. Okay. And Prabhupada writes in the purport, very beautiful and small purport. So he says, the last sentence I am reading. This is due to Pandavas and their confidence in Krishna. One who takes shelter of the Supreme Lord has nothing to fear even in the midst of greatest calamity. There is a lot of confidence and joy and auspiciousness on the side of this Pandavas. But that is missing on the side of Kauravas, on the side of Duryodhan and party. Pandavas are also Kauravas because they all belong to Kuru dynasty. So one should develop that confidence in Krishna. Then the signs of victory are evident. So we completed our first overview class on Bhagavad Gita, on the first chapter, first 19 verses. In the first verse, Dhritarashtra asked a question to Sanjaya. In the second verse, Sanjaya described that Duryodhan approached the Acharya Drona. Third, fourth, fifth and sixth verses, Duryodhan described Pandava's army. Seventh, eighth and ninth verses, Duryodhan described his own army. Tenth and eleventh verses, Duryodhan describes He gives a comparison between both the armies. From the 12th verse till 19th verse, we see 12th and 13th verses, they are describing how Bhishma blew his conch shell and there were so many kettle drums blowing in the battlefield. Okay, so many sounds were being made. From 14th verse till 18th verse is a description of how Krishna, Pandavas and many other warriors blew their conch shells on the battlefield. And the 19th verse describes that because of this blowing of conch shells on Pandava's side, the hearts of people on the side of Duryodhan were shattered. Okay. So, we concluded the topic. Thank you all very much.